Please join me in welcoming Promod Haque to the Atlanta High Tech Prayer Breakfast.
Thank you, Matt, for that kind introduction. I just want to point out I met a few criteria on that list that you showed us. And one more thing, we don't invest in smell IT. Well, good morning, everyone. I want to thank you for being here. I know it's very early, and I want to thank each and every one of you for taking the time to be here. I want to thank the organizers that have put this breakfast together and all the various sponsors that have contributed to make this happen. Let me tell you a little bit about what I do, and then I want to transition into who I am. By way of introduction, you know, I'm involved in a venture capital firm. You heard Matt talk about that. Have been doing that now for about 20 years. Norwest Venture Partners is located in Silicon Valley. We're a global venture fund. We have offices in Silicon Valley. We have offices in Tel Aviv, Israel. We have offices in Mumbai and Bangalore, and soon to be opening an office in Singapore. We make investments globally. We make investments here. About 80% of our investments are here, and the rest are in these various countries that I mentioned. We focus on a variety of different areas, sectors, predominantly the IT sector, the high technology sector, all the way from investments in semiconductor companies to investments in systems companies, storage companies, data networking companies, compute systems, to investments in software. That's an area that we specialize in, both infrastructure software as well as application software. Application software sold on a license basis, application software sold on a SaaS basis, as well as in the cloud. We also make investments in what we call technology-enabled businesses, and we also make investments in the health arena, healthcare arena, medical devices, healthcare informatics, and also some biopharmaceuticals. And then, obviously, the consumer internet space, search technologies and new computer advertising, internet advertising, ad networks, and a whole host of associated technologies. We're long-term investors. Our typical horizon when we make an investment is about 8 to 10 years, and we've been known to be on the boards of companies for about 10 to 12 years. We're patient investors. We look at ourselves as being value-add investors. When we partner with a company, we look at that as a partnership. We look at that as how do we help this and work together on a collaborative basis, help this venture to be successful. Our deal sizes are very interesting. They've changed. We are a large fund. We manage about $3.75 billion. Our last fund was a $1.2 billion fund that we raised in December of 2009. And so our deal sizes end up being very interesting. They go all the way from $250,000, which is very seldom, and they go all the way up to $60 to $70 million. And so you can imagine the kind of discussions that we have in our partners' meetings when we're making a $250K investment and then making a $60 million investment. So we invest in startups, we invest in mid-stage companies, we invest in late-stage companies. So we call ourselves as being stage-agnostic. We look at an opportunity, and if we think we can make money, and if we can add value, then that deal becomes interesting to us. Over our lifetime, the fund's fairly old. I joined 20 years ago. The fund's going to celebrate its 50th anniversary next year. It's one of the oldest funds in the country. We've funded more than about 500 companies over the lifetime. And, you know, they include companies like Cray Research and Actel and Teradata and PeopleSoft and Polycom and Brocade and Tivoli, which is now owned by IBM, and Cerent, owned by Cisco, and a whole host of other companies. And over the last 20 years, we've created 100,000 jobs, and we've created or helped create through our companies $50 billion in market cap. This is $50 billion of actual wealth created, not just for us, but also for all the other investors that were involved and entrepreneurs And if you look at the zero, almost the zero, not zero cost basis, but a low cost basis, the amount of tax revenue that has generated for both the feds and the state of California has been immense. I've had the pleasure personally of being on several boards. I've invested in about 70 companies in the last 20 years that I've been. Been on many, many boards, and I've had the privilege of working with companies like Tivoli and Serent and Sierra, which is now Redback, and now Ericsson, and a whole host of other companies. It's a real privilege and a pleasure to be involved in the high-tech community. It's a very unique community, as you all know, because you're involved in that as well. It's a delight and an excitement to work with entrepreneurs from all over the world, and to be able to collaborate with them, and to be able to identify with them, and to be able to work towards achieving a goal. High-tech is a unique society, and Silicon Valley especially is even more unique in that we have the opportunity to work with people from literally about 100 different countries. I have on my staff, my investment staff, I have people that come from various countries. I have Muslims on my staff, I have Jews on my staff, I have Christians on my staff, I have Hindus on my staff, and I also have agnostics on my staff. So people with all kinds of various backgrounds, grew up in different countries, Buddhists, Chinese, Indians, Israelis, Europeans, South Africans, and so on. So it's very unique. And in that sense, Silicon Valley is very unique in that people from Israel, people from Palestine, people from Pakistan, people from India, people from China can all work together and set their differences aside and be united and be unified in terms of achieving a common goal. And that is very, very exciting. So one of the things that I talk about the high-tech community in general, but also Silicon Valley, is that we encourage risk-taking. We encourage people to go out and take risks. And in the venture community, especially in the high-tech venture community, we don't look at failure as something bad. Failure is not a person. Failure is an event that happened in a person's life. In fact, when we recruit, when I recruit CEOs and VPs of marketing and VPs of engineering for various firms that I'm involved with, companies that I've funded, and also people that I recruit to come into our firm as investment managers, I look for people that have been successful, but I also look in their track records to see if they have made mistakes and if they have learned from those mistakes. And just because someone has had a mistake or a failure in the past is not a negative. It's actually a positive. We want to find people that have made mistakes and have learned from those mistakes, and preferably people that have learned from those mistakes and have made those mistakes on someone else's nickel, not mine. I'll say one more thing about investing globally. We invest in various countries, as I point out, and I occasionally get asked by people right here in the U.S., people that I work with, kids that I work with sometimes, even my own kids, Dad or Mr. Haque, what do you think about innovation in the U.S.? Are the days of U.S. innovation gone? Are you going to see countries like India and China and all other parts of the world emerging as innovation centers? What's going to happen to innovation here in the U.S.? And, I've got to tell you, after having, and I say this not just because it's the right thing to say, but I actually believe it down in the bottom of my heart. The best days for the U.S. as far as innovation is concerned are still ahead of us. And I'll explain to you what I mean by that. One of the things that I have learned over the years, both as a practicing engineer, but then also as an investor, is the fact that innovation is always done, successful innovation is always done in close collaboration and in close proximity to where the early adopters of technology are. It's always done in close collaboration and in proximity to where the early adopters of technology are. Now I'll just recite some numbers to you, and then I'll tell you a little bit more about myself. But I think it's important for people to hear this. If you look at the IT spending